It has been said that a new minister's first sermon, while he is still strange to his congregation and his congregation strange to him, frequently has far-reaching repercussions. You have your ideas of what your pastor should be, and your pastor has his ideas of what your church should be. I have come practically as a stranger to this imposing old church, a church whose history is almost as old as this country, a church whose traditions and legends I respect and find thrilling and exciting. Now, history and tradition and legends are fine. We couldn't live without the past. But past glory has never been enough for a nation or a church or even an individual. There's always the all-important now and the more important future. I look out this morning on a church not even half filled. Now, this in no way injures my personal pride, my vanity. I'm not here to recruit fans for a fellow named Peter Marshall. Nor am I here to sell anything. That which we call salvation, and a most comprehensive term it is a free gift. You can't buy it, neither can you earn it. It's not a reward dangling before the Christian like a carrot before a mule. It's not something that the church has to peddle. And probably no idea hurts me more than suggesting that I am a salesman endeavoring to sell people on the idea of religion. I resent it bitterly. Religion is not for sale. It's given away. So, today, as I start my ministry in this hallowed old church, I think it only fair to explain that it isn't the church or religion that I'm trying to present, but Christ. Not the pale, anemic, namby-pamby Jesus, the gentle Jesus, meek and mild, but the Christ of the Gospels, striding up and down the dusty miles of Palestine, suntanned, bronzed, fearless, the knuckles big in his carpenter's hands, the Christ who upset the moneylenders, the Christ who had a good time at weddings and who would not allow his host to be embarrassed by running short of wine, the Christ who loved people, all kinds of people, but particularly red-blooded folk, for he himself was red-blooded. The Christ who called a spade, and who let the chips fall where they might. Not the Jesus of the perfumed cloisters of pious sentiment, but the man who walked the streets of the city, stopping here and there to pass the time of day in places where you and I could not afford to be seen, and getting a huge kick out of it. Let us be honest. Let us recognize that the kind of people that Christ liked best were not the kind that the average church appeals to at all. Think of the people whom he personally invited to be his friends. Peter and Andrew, James and John, fish merchants, Zacchaeus and Matthew, unpopular tax collectors, Saul of Tarsus, an aristocrat, a persecutor of the church, Mary Magdalena, once a prostitute, Joanna, wife of Herod's chancellor, a so-called society woman. There are, I'm sure, in Washington, countless people who fall into just this category. We cannot afford to be indifferent to them. We must invite the sophisticates, the irreligious, the lost and the lonely. We must extend to them our fellowship and introduce them to Christ. That is our business, nothing else. For Christ likes people, all kinds of strange people. People whom we might have to think twice about before cultivating. He wants them. He enjoys their life and vigor. He wants to hear laughter. A joke, if it's a good one. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, that he was, but it was in order that our joy might be full. That is the Christ that I know. That is the Christ that I would have dwell in this historic old church, his big carpenter's hands stretched out in welcome. Let us pray.